Amen. Welcome, everybody. Good morning. Let's stand and sing, He Hideth My Soul in the Cleft of the Rock, hymn number 228. We're going to sing the first and the last. It's nice to see everybody this lovely morning. Let's sing to our Lord today. He hideth my soul.
A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. A wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. Shout with the millions on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand.
Well, hello, everyone. Welcome to Northern Park Baptist Church. Thank you so much for coming. Welcome you that are online. It is a good day to worship the Lord. It is a good day to gather together, and I hope and pray that you give him your all, and I tell you, what a blessing. Praise the Lord. Let's go ahead and bow our heads in a word of prayer today. Father, thank you that we can assemble ourselves here, and Lord, we look to you. We ask for your guidance, and Lord, we pray that you are pleased with all that is said and done today. And Lord, with every ounce of our being, Lord, I pray that, Lord, we will honor you and we will do our best, Father, with what we have. Lord, here it is. Here it's all. I just pray, Lord, that you'll take it and bless it and use it. And Lord, may today be a sweet day in your house. As we listen to your word, as we hear the music sung, Lord, may it truly be sweet in your ear. Lord, bless us, I ask today. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Want to just remind everybody about the ladies' tickets. Ladies, the 23rd, I believe it is the ladies' meeting, the ladies' luncheon. And so just be mindful of that. Get your ticket today. Also, men, this coming Saturday, 9 o'clock here at the church. It is the second Saturday now. And so the second Saturday, this Saturday, 9 o'clock, men to men. Keep that in mind. Now, this time the ladies are not meeting because the ladies are going to have their luncheon on the 23rd. But men, we're going to be meeting this Saturday, 9 o'clock. So be mindful of that. Of course, I know you're aware of what's around the corner. Hopefully you do. But on the 17th of April, it is Easter, and looking forward to what God would have for us. Of course, the choir will be doing their cantata that morning, in the morning service. But long before that ever happens, of course, we have what we call sunrise service. And that's going to be at 7 o'clock in the morning. Yes, that's early, isn't it? But there's a reason why it's early in the morning. And it's in remembrance of that morning when after the Lord rose from the grave, and when the women went to the tomb and all of that. And so we have a sunrise service. It's a very quick service, but we invite you to join with us. It's a very solemn type of service, and so that's at 7 o'clock, and then we'll have breakfast for those that are here at that time after that service. And then, of course, we have Sunday school, and then we have, which is at 10, and then, of course, the morning service is at 11, and then the evening service is at 6. So it is a filled day of, what do? Well, we get to worship the Lord. But this is special. On Easter, it is special because we are remembering what Jesus Christ did, not only on the rugged cross, but how he died, and then he rose again. And I tell you, it's a very fitting day. And so we encourage you to obviously not only be in attendance, but obviously invite your friends, people that need this world needs to know the God that sent his only begotten son, died on an old rugged cross, and he was buried. And on the third day, he arose. They need to know about that God, not this other God that they're promoting, but the God of the Bible. And so we want to encourage you to invite your friends and neighbor to come with us. All right, let's sing another song.
Now let's open our hymn books one more time to hymn number 427, Nothing Between. Hymn number 427, Nothing Between My Soul and the Savior. We'll be singing the first and the last. Nothing between my soul and the Savior, not of this world's delusive dream. I have renounced all sinful pleasure. Jesus is mine. There's nothing between, nothing between my soul and the Savior. So that his blessed face may be seen, nothing preventing the least of his favor. Keep the way clear, let nothing between, nothing between. In many hard trials, though the whole world against may be mean, watching with prayer and much self-denial, all triumph last with nothing between. Nothing between my soul and the Savior, so that his blessed face may be seen. Nothing preventing the least of his favor. Keep the way clear, let nothing between.
Amen. I don't know about you, but you had to concentrate on singing that song. And mentally, we are worn out just because of that. All right, ushers, let's come this morning. We're going to take an offering. And we encourage you to continue to give, to be faithful to the Lord. All right, let's go ahead and bow our heads. Brother Cross, would you mind leading us, please? Amen. God bless you as you give today.
I don't know about tomorrow. I just live from day to day. I don't borrow from its sunshine, for it's God.
wonderful song reminds us about a God that is there for us, reminds us about a God that not only acknowledges us and our troubles, but is willing to do something about it, that lifts us up and that leads us through the valley. I tell you, I don't know about you, but I love that kind of God. I love a God that cares that much, and He does care. God does care. Take your Bible this morning, turn to 2 Timothy chapter number 3, and if you're able to, would you please stand? Some of you should get used to this. Second Timothy chapter number 3. All right. I'm going to read our text, and then I'll pray, and then you can be seated. But then I'm going to go back a little bit. But anyway, here's our text for the day. You ready? 2 Timothy chapter 3, as you know, just for way of clarification, we have been in 2 Timothy ever since the beginning of the year. And so we're just slowly marching on. And so just to make you aware of it. Chapter 3, we are finally there. And as you know, Paul is writing to Timothy. This is what he says to Timothy. Verse 1, "This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come." And like many of you, you're probably saying, "Nope, we're there." And then Paul begins to proceed to describe the characteristics of this time. "For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God." By the way, if you've counting, that's 18. That's 18 different characteristics that we're going to preach on this morning. Just to let you know. But we also have another characteristic that is described, and this is a startling one as well. "Having a form of godliness." In other words, who Paul is describing here, they seem to be religious. "Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof." And then Paul's advice to Timothy, "From such, turn away." Let us pray. Father, I pray, Lord, that You would help us, that we be not a part of that crowd, that we would turn away from it. Dear God, maybe today some of us need to turn. May Your will be done in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. No doubt, the Apostle Paul is concerned and wanting to help Timothy. And I do want to point out, though, just by way of observing right quickly, if you don't mind. If you do, then that's okay too. But but in chapter 2, Paul instructs Timothy on being as a pastor, as a man of God, as Paul identified him as the servant of the Lord. I want you to listen carefully to what he says right quickly. Verse 24, and the servant of the Lord must not strive. In other words, don't be fighting and arguing with people. By the way, I've met a lot of preachers that are pretty good at that. But he says, and the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men. My Bible says, except Larry. I don't know what yours says, but I'm just kidding. But be gentle unto all men, or unto all. Apt to teach, patient. In other words, Paul here is instructing Timothy. Timothy, this is the way. I know you live in a culture to where right now it's quite volatile, and if you are not careful, you can get caught up in striving with one another. And it's not going to do you any good, Timothy. So be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient with them. And the Bible goes on and says, I think it's quite interesting, verse 25, in meekness instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. By the way, repentance always comes along with truth. It always does. And we need to, and people should repent of their error. They should repent because of what God has said, and they ought to turn to the Lord. And guess what? As Paul reminds Timothy, God will use you as you preach the truth, that those that oppose themselves, those that are in sin, those that are against what God would have, that by the grace of God, God could give them repentance. Boy, isn't it good to see people repent and turn to the Lord and all of that? I tell you, it hardly happens much these days, but it should. But Paul is reminding Timothy, and this I think is so encouraging. He says, in verse number 26, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. And Paul reminds Timothy of the enemy that we have, and that without a doubt, it is true, the devil as a roaring lion walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. That's the enemy we fight. And that's why we stand and we preach, and not according to this culture, not according to the style that is there, but simply just preaching the truth and being consistent with it day in and day out. Not trying to make it flashy or anything like that or palatable. Yes, we want to be very considerate. Yes, we want to be able to say it in such a way that people understand. And so, therefore, we have to work at it. I understand that. And I tell you, if there's anyone that boy, when he gets through preaching, he feels like this every time he gets off the pulpit because he never thinks he does an adequate job. But I'll learn. You know, after 30 years, maybe I can learn something. But I'm just telling you, without a doubt, that what is going on is, and Paul is reminding Timothy, you just simply be faithful to the truth of God. Because what's going on is this, that there are those that do oppose themselves. There are those that are in sin. There are those that are not going the right direction. Now, I will tell you this. Paul did not say, Timothy, it is your fault if they don't repent.
He didn't say that. Paul didn't say that. I don't know about you, but that encourages my heart. But Timothy, you just be faithful. You just do what God has called you to do. And because the thing about it is, every single one of us, you know, I can preach and I can just, you know, I just might get up and just read John 3:16 and explain it and go home. But as long as I'm faithful to do what God has called me to do, in other words, be faithful to preach his word. That's it. I'm not supposed to make up some other kind of doctrine. I'm not supposed to, I mean, it's not mine to make up. I already have his word, right? So I'm just to read it. I'm just to study it. And I am to apply it to this generation to the best of my ability. That's it, period. But the battle is when you and I hear it, then we are accountable for that. And I tell you, I don't know who it is that comes to hear. I don't know who's online. I don't know who listens there. But whoever it is, and as the Spirit of God works, I tell you, I know there's a devil. And maybe even right now this morning, there are people that are just so captivated by the devil. They're in the grips of his claws. Maybe today you've come because you want out of that. It will only happen by the truth, acknowledging the truth of God. And I tell you, I hope and pray for all of us that every single one of us, that we will repent. In other words, we'll turn to God because we want to turn away from sin and from the devil, and we want to reject the devil. Because I've seen enough people's lives destroyed because of sin. And so I wanted to say this because I wanted you to see and hear that process of repentance and what actually takes place. And I know a lot of times people come to church and they say, well, you know, that wasn't fun. I'm sorry. This is not intended to be fun. When I plan to go into a day, I promise you, it's not, we've got to somehow figure this out to be fun. That's not the plan. But I am trying to be faithful to what God says. I am trying to do the best that I can as far as preaching is concerned, you that are online. Because I know the battle is, we've got a devil here. We've got a devil that is winning. And I would love to see people repent and turn to the truth. But that's your call. That's you following the Lord. Amen. I'm sorry, please. Don't walk out of here and blame it on the preacher. I know we're good at scapegoats, and I know we're, you know, figure there he is, and we'll just blame it on him because he's, you know, I didn't like the way he preached. But if the truth went out, you and I are responsible for that truth. And we've got to do what God would have us to do with that truth. It just so happened God used a preacher to bring the truth. And so I tell you, you know, we live in such a culture. This morning we actually started a new lesson in our Sunday school class upstairs. Learning to be content in a consumeristic culture that we live in. Oh, I tell you, it's a major problem. It really is. But today, and it's quite fitting, as Paul writes to Timothy, he begins to describe the culture. He talks about the people of that culture. Of what's going to happen, or what I believe at that particular time, what was not only going on then, but It's going on today. And I hope and pray today that if you'll listen to what God would have for you concerning God and the Bible and what's influencing our world today. Well, listen to what the Bible says. In verse 1, it says, Paul, as he writes, says, "This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come." So he's talking about a time that shall come, a time that is in the near future, a time that apparently is going to be perilous. It's going to be dangerous. That's what it means to be. It's going to be hard. It's going to be difficult. And the reason why is because of wickedness or because of sin. Now, if you don't acknowledge sin, then you're going to be in trouble. You're going to have a hard time understanding this. Take your Bible this morning and turn to Romans chapter number 1. Romans chapter number 1 this morning. So Paul says to Timothy, "Hey, Timothy, I just want you to be aware of the fact that in the last days..." Now, by the way, Paul felt like he was in the last days. You know that? Of course, we believe today that we're in the last days. I mean, I've heard people say, "Boy, I don't know why the Lord doesn't come now. I mean, look how bad it is." And so I understand. But even Paul, in his day, things were so bad, he believed that the Lord could come at any moment, at any time. But in Romans chapter 1, notice if you would with me, and the reason why is describing a mindset, describing a generation, if I may say, or a culture of people. For the Bible says in verse 18, are you there? Chapter 1, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse." By the way, I do not believe that there will never be a human being that will be able to stand before God and say, "God, you're not fair," and have a legitimate excuse for it. Every man and every woman, I believe, will be without excuse. Not at all. I'm sorry, there's not anything you can bring before God, and God says, "Well, you know what? I understand. I'll give you a pass, and you can go on to heaven." I don't believe that at all. There will be none without excuse. But I do believe, though, that that every one of us will be responsible for what God has given us. Now that is the answer. That is the issue for sure. It's not that God has not spoken to our hearts about the things of God. It's not that God has not worked in our lives and showed us a clear plan of salvation and the right way. It's not that we're not aware of that, but it's what we did with it. And so as the writer writes here, notice if you would in verse number 21, "Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools." Verse number 23, I'm going to read down to verse 25. "And change the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man and to birds and to four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to be to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. Who changed the truth of God into a lie. And worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator." who is blessed forever. Amen. So here is a culture, here's a group of people that literally, though they were exposed to the truth, though they had no excuse not to know God, yet what did they do with it? And I believe every generation is responsible with what you and I have done with the truth of God. And as the Bible describes it there in Romans chapter 1, they changed the truth of God into a lie. They worshiped the creature more than the Creator. This is what they did. And so you and I, in the generation in which we live, have to choose on what we're going to do with the truth of God and how it applies to our lives and also the lives of those around us. And so Paul, dealing with quite a culture of a mess, he really is. I mean, there are those that are apostates, there are those that are false teachers, they are teaching a false gospel. And Christians that are not behaving properly, and Timothy is discouraged. And so instead of saying to Timothy, all right, well, why don't we just pack up and leave and go home? He's encouraging Timothy on how to deal with this. But now we get into a section. He says, know this also, Timothy, not that I am a bearer of wonderful news here, but let me just tell you, know this also that in the last days, perilous times shall come. One might, I can only imagine maybe Timothy thinking in his heart, oh, wonderful, more good news. Thanks, Paul. And I can almost imagine Timothy saying to himself, well, it's the times are pretty bad right now. But he says, in perilous times shall come. And yes, like probably many of you feel like, they're already here. I don't know how it can get worse, but I'm afraid it can get worse. But you know, whether it does or whether it doesn't, and I lean towards the fact that I believe it can. But how are you and I are going to deal with all this? Well, today we get to talk about some people. Now, for some of you, you like that. You like to sit around in a crowd and just chat. And you like to talk about other people's problems or what they're going through. Well, believe it or not, Paul does this with Timothy in the respect of describing the characteristics of this particular culture, this particular group of people. Now, obviously, we could, though we're not going to right now, how do they get here? But listen carefully. He says, for men shall be lovers of their own selves. Oh, I tell you, we live in a society today where that is so imminent, that is so a part of this culture. It's all about what I want, isn't it? And sadly enough, that is permanent. Well, you know, it's sad, though, when the church becomes like that. We're not supposed to be like that. But Paul reminds Timothy there's going to come a time where men shall be lovers of their own selves. By the way, you'll notice here that love is mentioned quite a bit here. Because the next one is covetousness. Well, what do you think that is? That's the love of money, of things, but the love of it. I mean, so much that it takes precedent, covetousness. But not only that, you'll notice also further down in that particular book, notice what it says in verse 5. Verse 4. Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. You know, just because someone mentions the word love doesn't necessarily mean it means the right thing. And here we have these people, as he describes them, lovers of their own selves, lovers of money, of covetous, you know, things like this. Also lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. Love, love, love. Let me tell you this, there's a right way to love and there's a wrong way to love. And apparently in this particular culture, they're just doing it all the wrong way. Boasters and proud, braggarts, proud. And obviously when you get people that living for themselves and it's all about them, then you've got pride building up. Proud. This is what's describing this particular culture. But not only that, blasphemers. Blasphemers. In other words, making fun, mocking that which is right or religious or good. Blasphemers. Disobedient to parents. Oh my goodness. We read that in Romans chapter 1 as well, but apparently there's a culture that will produce, or that, and sadly enough, it is ungodly. This ideal of being disobedient to parents, where at one time they used to honor their parents. By the way, that's a biblical concept. But here, perilous times, it's dangerous times, it's hard times. Well, one of the signs of that, or one of the products of that, is disobedient to parents. Boy, I tell you, our families are in such trouble as it is today. And disobedience to parents, they are unthankful. It's almost as if today children grow up, they think, I deserve this. Instead of being thankful for what they have received, instead of people being thankful for what they receive, they are unthankful for it. They feel like they deserve it. We live in that type of mentality today, by the way. That's what's dominating our society. What are you talking about? Well, what we're talking about is, as Paul writes to Timothy, it's describing a culture of people. They are unthankful. They are unholy. I tell you, it's not even right how children are treating their parents today. Not only, you know, divorcing their parents but doing ungodly things. I tell you, it would amaze you today if I were to talk about, you know, children killing their parents. All because, listen carefully, money, covetousness. And they'll do what they have to do no matter what. That's the society in which we live. I tell you, the things that people will do for money, it's amazing. One lawyer made reference that they'll do anything for $5. And it's sad. Disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection. Things that God has given us. And people are treating, are acting in such a way that it's, as one would call it, it's just unnatural. That's not how God made us. And yet we live in a society where it's becoming worse and worse of how God made us when it comes to children and parents, and parents ought to, our children ought to love their parents, and parents ought to love their children. I tell you, but the way it's acting today, it's unnatural. I mean, I've heard of parents killing their children. That is not right. But that's the society in which we live. And yes, I know it's We live in a society where we're so confused about love, and now there's people with that's not natural, people loving people they ought not to love. It's not natural. Men with men, women with women. It's hey, folks, it's sin. That's wreaking our society. No different than the drunkard that's consumed with alcohol, or the guy with porn and consumes his mind. And I mean, it's wickedness all around. And the truth of the matter is, you don't hate these people. You love them to the Lord Jesus Christ. You do. You got to care about him. You got to, because they have a soul. And yes, they're confused. And yes, and I tell you, I could go on and on and on about that. The world in which we live, men wanting to be women and women wanting to be men. It is unnatural. It just doesn't make sense. It's against biologic. It's against how God made us. And it's a mess. It's a mess. But folks, you don't hate those people. You do not. You love them. Hey, we live in America, don't we? People can do whatever they want to do. They can. And some people will choose that. Some people will choose to do things. But can I tell you, we still ought to love them. Not their sin, but we ought to love them and try to tell them about Jesus. Because I tell you, we have to live in this world. And we have to deal with this world. And so, but Paul says, without natural affection, Timothy, without natural affection, doing things that are just against nature, truth breakers. In other words, they're liars. Not willing, or maybe even not even able to keep the truth. Not willing to make a covenant and stay with it. False accusers. In other words, lying and on someone, but it's not true. False accusers. In other words, they apparently there's a culture of lies. In other words, there's a culture that will raise up that cannot speak the truth and cannot stay with the truth and is unwilling to live with the truth. That's sad, to be in that society. If you ever talk to someone that cannot be straightforward with you, they're always dodging, they're always lying about everything. Sad. False accusers. Of course, they did that with Jesus, if you remember. Incontinent. Fierce. This ideal of not only being angry but to the point of volatile at any moment, at any time. Despisers of those that are good. Even when they know the truth, or when the truth is there, they will do everything they can to discredit the truth and those that are involved. Don't you love talking about other people? No, probably not. But as Paul makes this list, and it is a long list, despisers of those that are good. Well, that's not going to happen in our society. That wouldn't happen in our church. Traitors? Traitors? Heady, in other words, rash, daring, bold. In other words, they'll do whatever it takes for evil. Heady, heady people. High-minded, puffed up, high-minded, thinking more of themselves than they ought to think. High-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. Whatever it takes, we like pleasure. And we'll do whatever because the ultimate goal is pleasure. We want to feel good. We live in that world today, sadly enough. You'd be surprised how much money this world pays for pleasure, for entertainment. When it comes to drugs, when it comes to alcohol, when it comes to making us feel good, how much money goes into it. It would surprise all of us. It's not a wonder. It's not a wonder that we've lost our way. It's not a wonder our society in which we live has lost its direction. It's not a wonder God is growing dim in the background while all this other is totally gaining momentum in our society. Every society is responsible for what they're going to do with God. Did you know that the fact that you choose to come to the house of God says something about you? It says that, at least to some degree, it says that you want to hear from God. It says that you want God in your life. If you read the Word of God anytime during the week, that says something about you. It says that you want to hear from God, that you're trying to learn, you're trying to grow about concerning God. But you see, every culture, every generation is responsible for what you and I do with God. I only have one life, and so do you. And what you and I do with that life remains to be seen. I do way too many funerals, but quite often I hear a lot of regret. I hear, and some funerals are just so sad because they wasted their life. In other words, they did whatever they wanted to do, and it shows. And so you come to the end, and so God is absent. God is absent in their ending. And that's sad. So as Paul writes to Timothy, he gives him this advice. After Paul describes this culture, this generation, that perilous times shall come. And he describes the characteristic of this group. And I just went through it. Boy, it was a boring sermon. But it was necessary. Because, folks, I believe we live in that culture. So to stick our head in the sand and not to, you know, just to forget about it, that culture is affecting the church. That culture you and I have to deal with every day of our lives. And so instead of being judgmental and instead of, thinking we're better than everyone else, it ought to break our hearts. It ought to cause us to love God more and to put us on our knees before a holy God. Because that culture is what you and I live in. And I don't want my generation to go to hell. I don't want families' lives to be torn apart. And so Paul said to Timothy in verse number 5, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. You know how sad it is when we go through the motions but we don't really connect to the one that has the power? Do you know how vain that is? How empty that is? In other words, we have a shell of religion. We have, you know, it's all on the outside, but really and truly on the inside, there is no God. And boy, that ought to wake us up. Some of us, we have God, but we don't do anything with Him. And that's sad. I mean, you get convicted, you know the truth. I mean, good grief, you've heard the good old hymns of the faith. You know all of that, but you do nothing with it. Alan, this is not a time to quit, is it, church? It is not a time to just throw up and just go ahead and kowtow to our culture. It's not a time to do that. Boy, if there's any time that this world needs to see the truth of God, it's now. I know that we are in Fundamental Independent Baptist Church. And boy, I tell you, I could take all those names and say, boy, it sure doesn't fit in our culture today. I don't care. My relationship has nothing to do with the sign out there. My relationship has everything to do with what God's done in here, right here. And so do you. Sure, I know that marquee out there has, it just has the name of the church. But as far as our God is concerned, are we going to allow the culture to determine how we behave and what we do? Or are we going to take seriously what God has said in His Word and start living the way God would have us to live? Because what has happened is, and Paul's advice to Timothy was correct, he says, from such turn away. In other words, don't let this culture influence you. Don't get involved with this culture to the point that it changes you. It will be bad when that happens. So we are to turn away from this. Don't let this world influence you. And our children are at stake. Our parents are at stake. Our society is at stake as far as people in general. We can't just go dig a hole in the ground somewhere and stay there until it all passes. And that's not what Paul was telling Timothy. But he was telling him, don't let this culture affect you. Maybe this morning some of us have to raise our hand and say, preacher, it has. I'm not what I used to be when it comes to the things of the Lord. By the way, you live in this world, you can't help but it affecting you. That's why we ought to do everything we can to guard ourselves. That's why you and I got to do everything we can to be dedicated to Him and focus our attention on Him in spite of the world in which we live. Hey, there's always been sin, right? There always has. So don't blame this culture for how come you're not faithful to God. Because the blame goes to you. Come on. So let's put our big boy pants on and take responsibility for what we have done. Sure, we can blame all the other crowds and all the ungodliness that, you know, the people in the White House and people in the Congress and all that stuff. We can blame them all we want. But it's you and I. I don't know about you. I don't know why don't we just say this start sign right now. God, by your grace, I'm going to focus more on you. I'm going to live for you. Now, I'm not very good at it, God, but I sure need your help. I want to try to live the way you want me to live in such a society that we live in today. God, help me to be the mom, the dad, the whatever you are. God, help me to be what you would have me to be. Help me to quit excusing. Help me to quit blaming everybody else. And God, help me just to take responsibility for my actions. And may I live according to you. Because without a doubt, this society, this culture needs the truth. And it's going to go the wherever it's going to go. It is. You can't make people love Jesus. You can't make people get saved. I've tried. Doesn't work. But you know what? You can do what you would need to do. That's the one you're responsible for. So right now, would you stand, every head bowed, every eye closed? As our pianist comes this morning, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, Timothy, from such turn away. Hopefully this morning, we're not just having a form of godliness. Do we have any here this morning? Maybe God's knocking at your heart's door because you're just playing a game. You're just going through the motions. That's all you're doing. Folks, let me tell you this. It's real. God is alive and well. And it's a real thing when God convicts a heart of their need of a Savior and that sinner calls upon the name of the Lord to save their soul. That is real. But my question to you, have you ever done that before? Have you ever acknowledged in some form or way that you are a sinner, that you need the Lord, that you recognize Jesus Christ as the only one that can save you? And the Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Have you done it? But for those of us that are saved, are we just going through the motions? In other words, we're saved. We can do anything we want to. We don't have to take this old church stuff seriously. Come on. Let's get real. God can change your life. But he's not going to change your life over your will. If you don't want him, he's not going to do it. So don't you think it's time for you and I to get serious about our God? Let's don't go with this culture. Let's don't go with this generation. Let's live for God now. Our piano begins to play this morning. I don't know how God has spoken to your heart. But church, don't you think it's time that we get serious, in spite of our generation, with what God is doing in our hearts right now? Are you playing a game? Brother Miguel's going to lead us in a song here in just a moment. And as he does, would you do business with the Lord? Would you get right with God? Would you just have your altar session right there, or maybe up here at an altar. Father, have your will and way this morning, and dear God, may we not be guilty of looking at everybody else and seeing how bad they are and somehow walking away thinking we're so good. Dear God, help us to do business with you today. And Lord, it is that temptation that this world can affect us. And that's not the way it's supposed to be. Are we supposed to care? Yes. Are we supposed to pray? Yes. Dear God, we ought to love people enough to show them Jesus, not accept their sin. So, Lord, do a work in our hearts today. In Jesus' name, amen. Brother Miguel leads us in a song. You do what God would have you do. Come on, as we sing.
Way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay.
This is our prayer. Mold me and make me. Not this world mold me and make me, but Father, you mold me and make me.
I am waiting.
As we sing again, the next verse, brother. Have thine own way, Lord. What about it?
Own way.
Boy, isn't that a prayer? Shouldn't that be a prayer of ours?
Master, today, whiter than snow, Lord.
Good job. Lift your voice.
Just now, as in thy presence, humbly I bow.
Oh, may God change the church. May God work in our hearts. Because I tell you, our culture, our generation needs Christians that are Christians. They're like the Lord. Amen. Well, thank you so much for being with us today, church. And I hope and pray that you take this challenge seriously and don't forget it, all right? And be praying about the service tonight. We're going to meet again. And by the way, it's a different message. And 6 o'clock tonight, so come back and be with us, okay? And also be praying for, I tell you, it sure is good to see Sister Pat today. And of course, Brother Bill Lawrence is here as well. And pray for these and as they recover and for God's will to be done. All right. Ladies, just a reminder about the tickets. And again, fellas, this coming Saturday, 9 o'clock, sure want to see you. And ladies, you're not meeting this Saturday, but the 23rd, you have your ladies' luncheon. Okay. All right. Let's be dismissed in a word of prayer. Choir to 9 to 5 o'clock, right? All right, so Brother Miguel, won't you dismiss us in prayer?
Thank you for this day, and thank you for your message, Lord. Help us to rely on you. Help us to seek more of your will, more of your guidance, more of your wisdom, more of your grace, Lord, so we can be an example and a testimony to the neighbors around us, our city, our churches around here, Lord. Help us to not fall into their temptation, Lord, but to help them understand your will. Help them understand your mercy and your grace, Lord, that you love them. And help us, Lord, to just be an example and a testimony, Lord. Now protect us as we go back home. Keep us safe today. And bring everybody back to hear more of your word and to worship your name more and more today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.